Penguin Random House Audio presents The Island Dwellers, Stories by Jen Silverman. Read for you by Kristen C., Saskia Marleveld, Cassandra Campbell, Sunila Nankani, Rebecca Lohman, Brittany Presley, Alex McKenna, Vikas Adam, Renata Friedman, Hannah Cabell, and Julia Whalen. To my parents, Mark and Sue, and to my brother Chris. Girl Canadian Shipwreck. When I was younger and I heard about anybody trapped anywhere, my first response was always just, why don't you leave? Trapped in a job? Leave. Trapped in a place? Leave. Trapped in your car under a river? Crank the window open and swim to freedom. It was a great and simple solution that I alone had come up with, and I didn't understand why nobody else had managed to grasp the concept. Among my friends, I was the messiah of this movement. I said things like, if that apartment sucks, just move. And if you need to fuck a lot of people, just leave him. And study abroad. My friends said things like, oh, and wow, and and it's not that simple, and you make it sound so simple. When I grew older, however, it wasn't so much that I learned that I was wrong. This is still a philosophy that intellectually I subscribe to. But rather that there were scenarios I hadn't thought of. For example, imagine an island. You are on this island. You are alone. There's nobody else with you. Leave, you might say. Okay, but you need a boat. There is no boat on your island, so you need to build a boat. Build a boat, you might say. Okay, but you don't know how, and there is no Wi-Fi on your island, so you can't look it up on YouTube. But okay, you can guess how to build a boat. It involves chopping down trees and hewing them and fastening them and, fuck it, you'll build a raft. But you need tools. You need sharp tools that will chop through wood. You have no tools. And you're so tired. This entire attempt has made you tired. So what are you going to do? Well, you don't know. And you haven't given up on the idea of leaving. But you're just going to sit very still for a time. You're just going to sit very still and not move at all and try to filter the right answer out of the shadow that is descending from the canopy of uncuttable trees that loom over your head. You see, there is a scenario in which you can't just leave. Now imagine that there are 100 of these islands, and on each island is a little person crouched down on the ground, trying to filter sense out of shadow without a boat. Now you have 100 people who can't just leave. And so it goes. Sometime in June, I go see Camilo perform. We've been dating for 2 years, and as Camilo's girlfriend, it's my duty to attend his first performance piece in all that time. He's so excited that I can't tell him my deep personal failing, namely, that I don't like performance art. I think either you're performing or you're making art. I think that performance art is something that people do because they're not good enough actors to just perform, and they're not skilled enough artists to just make art. But I don't say this. On my way to the venue, a basement in deepest Brooklyn, I talk out loud to myself. I practice telling Camilo that I love his work, without sounding like I'm lying. It's harder than you think, but I find that it relies more on tone of voice than words, and by the time I get there, I sound convincing. Camilo's friends, Ev and Kira, meet me on the sidewalk outside. Ev has been a lesbian, but Ev is about to transition into being a man. Ev's current gender pronoun of choice is E. Ev says that certain things are inherent, that E identifies as gay before E is a gender, and therefore when E fully becomes a man, E will have no choice but to date men. I understand the idea of inherence, as in, this person is inherently skilled. This person is inherently clumsy. I am concerned because Camilo is inherently clumsy with things like words and money and other people's feelings. He loses his socks and he interrupts you. If you are inherently clumsy, chances are slim that you will make finely tuned work. We crowd into the basement. Kira keeps her sunglasses on. Kira is only here for Camilo. She wants that to be clear. Kira is the friend you talk to when things go wrong in your life because things are constantly wrong in hers. She is very good at telling you it is not your fault, when quite possibly it is your fault. This is a good friend for you to have, but not a good friend for your girlfriend because you will only ever mention her to Kira when you are angry and sad. Sometimes I make Camilo sad. And this is the first thing Kira knows about me. She knows that I once said that I didn't understand how Camilo's friends could protest the death penalty and then walk by homeless people on the street. If you believe all human life has value, which I do not, then shouldn't you act accordingly at all times? Camilo wouldn't speak to me for a day after that, nor would he articulate which part of my statement upset him the most. What Kira does not know about? The time Camilo and I skipped work, took the metro north outside the city to Dia Beacon, and ate picnic sandwiches on the grass. The time we read the entirety of Roald Dahl's The Twits out loud on the subway during a trip from the top of Manhattan to the tail of Brooklyn. The time Camilo had a brief but intense nervous breakdown after a prolonged phone call with his mother, and I stayed up the whole night talking him through it. These are not the things you would ever tell a friend like Kira, even if they are also part of the map of your relationship. Kira has one map, and the friend to whom you tell all your good things has the other map. And you just have a jumble of chicken scrawl on a napkin. And that is why your friends always think they know where you should be going, and yet you yourself are so often lost. For the past 2 years, I have been dating Camilo and not leaving. I moved to the large brownstone co-op in which he lives, where things like books and plants and people go missing, slide between the cracks of the ancient and splintering floorboards. There are whole countries that have gone missing inside this house. There are people who emerge from doorways, and their faces are unrecognizable faces, because they are faces that have gone missing as well. In this way, Camilo and his house together are not unlike the island of Dr. Moreau. Now we're in the basement. We're invited to line the walls, standing or kneeling, creating an open rectangle in the center. There is a microphone, waiting at the end of the open rectangle. The concrete floor is cool under my knees, and it feels good after the humidity outside. As the last people trail inside and settle into a hush, Camilo walks out. We are silent, eyes trained on him. He is wearing a white t-shirt. The armpits are stained. The elastic of his black sweatpants is too old. They're sagging dangerously at the waist, and his long hair is loose. I can't tell if he looks like an artist or a serial killer. I hope everybody in the room is thinking he looks like an artist. I hope they're thinking about how authentic he seems, how unfettered by societal norms. I briefly hate myself for even letting the thought serial killer slip across my mind. Ev, Kira, and I arrange our faces to look encouraging. Kira makes a little, yeah, noise. A little, go get him, tiger, noise. But Ev is completely focused. Ev also identifies as a performance artist and is taking this seriously. Regardless of why we're here, we all want him to succeed. We desperately want this to be good. The better it is, the less lying we will have to do. Camilo starts to windmill his arms. I think he's stretching. He's working up to something. He's preparing for takeoff. He keeps windmilling. Any minute now, he's going to stop, shake himself off, and begin something that requires very loose shoulders. He keeps windmilling. Now 2 minutes have passed, and Camilo is still very vigorously windmilling his arms. I sneak a sideways look at Kira. Her sunglasses are still on, and you can't see her eyes. And suddenly, I'm jealous that I didn't think of wearing sunglasses. Now it's 3 minutes. I am starting to be concerned for Camilo's rotator cuffs. My best friend is in med school, and she has told me about rotator cuff injuries and how often they require surgery. She has told me that you may think cartilage is tough, but actually, in certain situations, it tears like paper, and then you're fucked. Camilo's cartilage might be tearing this very second. And for what? Now it's 4 minutes. Kira's sunglasses reflect a small and determined Camilo, glistening with sweat, churning his arms in circles. Ev gets up. For one shocked moment, I think he is going to leave. He has decided that this is not art and is going to leave. Is this a gesture of great friendship because of the depth of its honesty? Should I, as his girlfriend, be so honest as well? The idea is wild and liberating. Then Ev walks to the microphone stand, and I realize that Ev and Camilo must have agreed to this ahead of time. There is a piece of paper taped to the stand. He lifts it up. He begins to read. As Camilo windmills his way up and down the room, Ev reads a series of sentences about Camilo's mother. These are recollections from when Camilo was a child. His mother is cool and brutal and absent. The sentences all seem to begin, "I am 6, or 8, or 4, or 10, and my mother," and then they finish badly. She frightens him, she chastises him, she abandons him for days or weeks at a time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.